Resuming debate, the honourable member for Chilliwack, Fraser Canyon.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, and I'm grateful for this opportunity to address the committee the whole here and to add my voice to those who have already expressed their support for the men and women of the Canadian Forces. It's good to be here with my colleagues, with the Minister of National Defence, the Associate Minister, as well as General Natinchuk, and Mr. Chair, one of the perhaps the greatest honour in my young political career came when I joined the General in Esquimalt, welcoming home the HMCS Vancouver and her crew from the deployment in Libya. Thank you to the General for being there for that. Mr. Chair, as you know, the primary responsibility of the Canadian Forces is to protect and defend Canada. This is a vast country covering 10 million square kilometres, and bordered by over 200,000 kilometers, 200,000 kilometers of coastline. These numbers are staggering, and it is awe-inspiring to think that roughly 40% of that landmass and 75% of that coastline is contained in our rugged Arctic. This region has an important historical and symbolic significance to the cultural makeup of our country. As you know, with each passing year, Northern Canadians are affected more and more, one way or another, by their changing environment. As waterways are becoming increasingly navigable, traffic into and through their region is on the increase. The potential for new transportation and trade routes is becoming a reality, just as the desire from both inside and outside of Canada to access the vast resources found in the Arctic increases. Obviously, this is a time of tremendous and some would say unequaled opportunity. Mindful of that opportunity, in 2009, our government released its Northern Strategy on behalf of all Canadians, from the North and the South, to ensure that together we could carefully monitor and protect our Arctic environment, promote and support both economic and social development in the North, improve and devolve governance so that more decision-making is in the hands of Northerners, and continue exercising Canada's sovereignty in the North so that we can deliver on these goals. And to achieve this vision, our government is working through provincial, territorial, and local governance structures, working with Northern Canadians so that they can achieve sustainable improvements to their economic, environmental, and social well-being over the long term, and working with Northerners so that they can exercise the same kind of control over their own future as Canadians in any other part of the country. The defence team plays a valuable supporting role in the North, collaborating seamlessly with Northern communities and with other government departments like Aboriginal Affairs and Northern Development Canada, Public Safety, and the Department of Fisheries and Oceans, learning from Northern residents about how to work and survive in this beautiful and often forbidding part of our country. And they have tapped into this fountain of knowledge and experience through the Canadian Rangers program. These Rangers, made up of over 4,000 Canadians of mostly Inuit, First Nations and Métis descent, give the Canadian Forces an important and permanent presence in the North. They exercise our sovereignty by reporting unusual activities, collecting local data in support of the Canadian Forces, and patrolling our country's Arctic. Just last month, they and a number of their military colleagues wrapped up Operation Nunalivut, which saw them conduct sovereignty patrols over thousands of kilometres in some of the most remote an inhospitable land on Earth. The Rangers also play a valuable role in mentoring and educating troops from the South about how to manage, respect, and ultimately care for the North. Clearly, they are crucial to Canada's Arctic. This is why our government has taken steps to give them new equipment, including new GPS units, radios, binoculars, and survival equipment to help them better perform their important role. And it's why we are committed to expanding the Canadian Ranger program to over 5,000 members, a target our government has made great progress on in the last 5 years, and one that it is now close to meeting. We're also looking beyond our borders for partners, because we have learned that partnership is not only a way of life in the North, it is the key to success. That's why we recently worked through the Arctic Council to establish a legally binding Arctic Search and Rescue Agreement, something the Canadian Forces continues to lead on, including through a multinational tabletop exercise hosted by Canada last fall. It's why the Chief of Defence Staff recently hosted a meeting of his counterparts from other northern countries to discuss issues of common interest, particularly support to civilian authorities. and it's why we regularly invite our Arctic neighbours to participate in some of our military training in the region, most notably Op Nanook, our largest annual Arctic exercise. This exercise showcases our sovereignty as the Canadian Forces brings together local, territorial and federal stakeholders, and it highlights the need for cooperation in a place where no one can hope to succeed alone. This fact was tragically reinforced during last year's Op Nanook, when First Air Flight 6560 crashed near Resolute Bay, and the Canadian Forces, working with civilian authorities and other partners, were able to rescue the three survivors and quickly get them to the hospital. Mr. Chair, initiatives like Op Nanook allow lead departments and the Canadian Forces to combine traditional Indigenous knowledge and know-how on the ground with more modern capabilities like aerial patrols conducted by the Royal Canadian Air Force, maritime patrols in partnership with the Canadian Coast Guard, and even space-based satellite systems to provide detailed surveillance and monitoring of the North on behalf of the Government of Canada. Our government recognizes what advanced equipment and facilities can make possible in the North, and that's why it is carrying through on measures to increase the Canadian Forces' capabilities and infrastructure in the region. 6 to 8 Arctic offshore patrol ships, the first of which we can expect to take the water later in this decade, will provide an important presence in the area as icebound passages become navigable. We're also continuing the development of a berthing and refueling facility in Nanisivik, and of an Arctic training centre in Resolute, which will reinforce our presence in the area, and just as importantly, serve as a place where our men and women in uniform can learn to operate effectively in the North, availing themselves of both the wisdom of the Rangers and of modern technology and approaches. Mr. Chair, the Arctic lies at the heart of our identity as Canadians. For decades, its remoteness and severe weather kept it immune from much of the change and many of the dangers affecting the rest of Canada and the world. An increased interest in the Canadian Arctic has brought with it real challenges to this precious part of our country and its inhabitants. The Department of National Defence and the Canadian Forces play an important and an even vital role in Canada's Arctic. Canada's armed forces have developed knowledge, partnerships, and capabilities that make them especially suited for work in Canada's north, and this government is committed to building on these so that the Canadian forces continue to be valuable contributors to our Arctic security. Now, Mr. Chair, I do have a question for the Associate Minister. Our Conservative government made a commitment to rebuild the fleets of the Royal Canadian Navy and the Canadian Coast Guard, and as a result, launched the National Ship Procurement Strategy, which our government was widely commended for. While much of the focus has been on the shipbuilding contract award process, what hasn't been as clear is the impact that this will have on the Royal Canadian Navy and the Canadian Forces as a whole. Can the Associate Minister explain the benefits that this will have for our Canadian Forces?
The Honourable Associate Minister for National Defence.
Mr. Chair, I want to thank the Honourable Member for his question. And at the same time, I want to also clear up my response earlier, or my comments earlier with regards to the Canadian Surface Combatants. This is in definition phase planned for summer 2012, just to be clear. In any event, Mr. Chair, the government is establishing strategic relationships with Vancouver Shipyards and Irving Shipbuilding, the two Canadian shipyards selected for the construction of large ships, both combat and non-combat. Our government has taken a leadership role in bringing the boom-bust cycle to an end in our national shipbuilding industry. The strategy will create considerable opportunity for Canada's marine industry in all regions by contributing to the building of large ships, competing to build smaller ships, and conducting life extension, refit, and repair work. Industry analysts have estimated that the government shipbuilding projects would contribute directly and indirectly to some 15,000 Canadian jobs and over $2 billion in annual economic benefit over the next 30 years. Mr. Chair, for the first time, our shipbuilding industry will have stable, secure work that will allow them to invest in the latest technology, develop highly skilled workforces, and regain Canada's shipbuilding reputation. Our ships will be made in Canada by Canadians. The previous government sat by watching our domestic shipbuilding capacity crumble as more and more Canadians lost their jobs. This government, our government, has taken a proactive role to ensure we have jobs, industrial capacity, and an economically viable model, in a process that even the opposition parties have applauded. We have achieved two important goals. We have ensured the future strength of Canada's shipbuilding industry, and we have maintained our domestic capacity to equip our Navy, our Royal Canadian Navy, Coast Guard, research and science vessels, and for which I believe Canadians would well be proud of the work that we're doing.
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Fraser Canyon.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This question is for the Minister of National Defence. The brave men and women of the Canadian Forces have demonstrated leadership on a global scale and have taken on a leadership role in a multitude of missions across the world. Maritime security offers another opportunity for Canada to continue to play a leadership role with our allies. Maritime security is an ongoing concern for not only Canada, but many of our major allies and partners. Is the Minister of National Defence able to inform this Committee of the Whole of Canada's contributions to address global maritime security concerns?
The Honourable Minister of National Defence.
I want to thank the member from Chilliwack-Fraser Canyon. Like him, I come from a coastal community, and maritime security is, of course, now an enormous role within the Canadian Forces. It's an enormous role within NORAD, with maritime approaches now falling under that command. With respect to what Canada is doing currently, we have 1,300 Canadian soldiers, as was mentioned earlier by the Parliamentary Secretary, deployed on 15 international missions. Global security, of course, includes the deployment of naval assets. And with respect to ongoing missions, we have sailors aboard HMCS Charlottetown, making contributions to maritime security through Operation Active Endeavour, which is NATO's mission to prevent the movement of terrorism and weapon at sea. This ongoing mission within the Mediterranean. Canadian forces are also part of successful operations such as Operation Jaguar, which completed its mandate in November of this past year with respect to counter-narcotics missions. Operation Jaguar began with a request from the government of Jamaica to deploy assets, both aviation and naval assets, in assisting in the mandate to conduct essential training and search and rescue operations, Mr. Chair, which we were speaking of a moment ago. Also, we've had the privilege of announcing the participation of HMCS St. John's and its shipborne CH-124 Sea King helicopter in Operation Carib. We've seen Canadian forces contribute as well to Op Martello, a binational joint interagency and multinational collaboration effort with the Western Hemisphere. Operations also, we know, in the future, training operations will include our Canadian submarines, Mr. Chair, including in the operations that will take place, training operations in the Pacific, and throughout the course of these activities, we are extremely proud of our sailors, all that they provide with our naval assets and our air assets, also working with other agencies, including the Coast Guard. This is important work given the size of our coastline, the largest coastline of any on the planet, and Mr. Chair, this is as well why the Associate Minister has referred to the naval build that we are seeing, a historic naval build which will see the replacement of all of our fleet of combat vessels in addition to icebreakers and Arctic patrol vessels.
There's time for a very short question. The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Fraser Canyon.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. When I was with the General on the HMCS Vancouver, I saw him gather the sailors around and say to them, if I get this right, it's who ought to ask for help. At the highest level, the General has made it clear that mental health of the soldiers, sailors, and air crew is of utmost importance. So I'm hoping that the Minister of National Defence can expand once again on the investments that we've made in the area of mental health.
A short answer from the Minister of National Defence.
I thank the member, Mr. Chair. And look, I too have had the great pleasure to stand in admiration to see our Chief of Defence Staff, Canada's top soldier, address those brave men and women, and to speak to them personally and passionately about the importance of coming forward, of self-diagnosing, of recognizing that there is a need to get help, but most importantly, that the help is there. And to do away with any stigma or any negative connotation that it is somehow unlike a soldier to ask for help. Soldiers are the toughest, most diligent, most patriotic, and passionate Canadians, but there is times in their life where they do need the help and they do need to reach out. And that's why we continue to make these important investments to provide not only the physical surroundings, but the individuals, the personal support, the chaplains, the psychiatrists, the mental health professionals, and we will continue to make those important investments in that most important asset, and that is our personnel and the help that they need. Here we go.